great thou art. You may be seated.
Prayer. One more time before we get started. Thank you. Dear Lord, we just come to thank you. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this, what we get to celebrate today, Lord. Lord, today have your way. Your word is alive. So as we read it, bring it alive within us. Hearts and our minds for what you have to say to us today, because you are a personal Jesus. We just thank you. Have your way today, Lord. Amen. What a good morning. Wow. Jesus is alive. Oh, so good. That's worth it. If every day nothing else goes right, at least Jesus is alive. And we can count on that. And some days, that's the only hope that we have. But it's a great hope. It really is. Oh, my heart is elated this morning. Jesus is good. Now, this morning, I'm getting to celebrate a baptism together, and we have a few more coming up in a couple weeks. If that tugged on your heart at all, and you're like, man, God, I'm ready. I'm ready to make this next step with you, let us know. Those cards that you got this morning, there's a QR code on there, and it takes you straight to a connection. That email goes straight to me. No one else sees it but my eyes. And so if you are like, yes, I'm ready, man, don't hesitate. Send that message, and we'll talk about it. Now, what a good day to talk about new life. Today we're going to be in the book of Matthew. Today's message is one that it's for every day. It's so appropriate on Easter. But Easter is every day because Jesus is alive every day. And so today we're gonna dig in a little bit. Matthew chapter 16, 24 through 27. It says, "Then Jesus said to his disciples, 'If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. You benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? For the Son of Man will come with his angels in the glory of his Father and will judge the people according to their deeds.'" Now, something in there. We're going to talk about why. Why do we want to give our souls to Jesus? You know, why are our souls important? Life. Life is hard. It is. We experience things that don't make sense, and we don't know why. But this world's not as God designed it to be. God designed a perfect world. But when sin entered, so did tragedies, amongst other things. You know, those things that happen and we don't know why. Man, it's that sin that entered. But there's a hope with because God says, I didn't make this world. It's not as I made this world, but it is not as I intended. So follow me. I will hold you through the hard times. I will walk you through what is coming. So why is that important for us? Matthew chapter 10, verses 37 and 39. It says, "If you love your father or mother more than you love me, you are not worthy of being mine. Or if you love your son or daughter more than you love me, you are not worthy of being mine. If you refuse to take up your cross and follow me, you are not worthy of being mine. If you cling to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for me, you will find it." Verse 37 can seem a bit harsh. It can. man, like, if you love someone else more than me, then you're not worthy of me. Like, that can be harsh. But it's real. And what that means, though, is that if we love Jesus above all else, first and foremost, if we love Jesus above all else, first and foremost, above everything, that makes us a better spouse. That makes us a better parent. That makes us a better son and daughter. It makes us better, and that's why Jesus says that. That's why he says, if you love your father or mother or your children more than me, you're not worthy of being mine. Because when we put Jesus first, we become the best. Because Jesus is, humans let humans down. It happens. Even the ones we love, Matt and I let each other down. I say, hey, I'm not going to go through McDonald's today and get a black iced coffee. I'm going to try really hard to not do that and stay on budget. And then, you know, it's about 2 o'clock in the afternoon and the twins are running rampant. And I'm like, man, I really need an iced coffee right now. And then I go through and then I send Matt a text and I say, please forgive me. I was bad. I let you down. I got that iced coffee. And he says, oh, babe, it's all right. Let's try again tomorrow. You know, and it goes both ways. In any relationship, we're human. We let each other down. But you know who never lets us down is Jesus. Because he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he never lets us down. Now, so that's why he says, you know, put me first. It'll work out. Now, verse 38, taking up our cross here means to be willing to identify with him publicly. To be willing to face whatever may come for the good of the kingdom. Now, this doesn't mean be hateful to people in Jesus' name in public. It doesn't mean to beat people down with a Bible. That's not okay. We should never do that. What this is saying is that when we have Jesus in our life, and first and foremost, we start standing on his word. We become transformed. Things within us that are bad start to die and break off, and they're replaced with good things. You know, once upon a time, my attitude was horrible, pre-Jesus. Man, I was climbing that corporate ladder, and I did all I could to do it. It's not good. And then, you know, to make matters worse, I'd wash it down with way too much alcohol. Way too much. And then I came to know the Lord, and he set me free. Was it overnight? The attitude wasn't. It took time. It took time. But there was something in me that desired more. I wanted to be a better person. I had a reason to be a better person. That corporate ladder didn't matter to me anymore because Jesus had a plan for my life, and I wanted that because I'd been chasing all these other things for far too long. And then I put down the bottle. That was a miraculous put down. 10 years ago in January since I've had a sip. And Matt and Mick, we all quit at the same time to support each other because I would come home every night and that was my vice. But it was way too much. But God, he changed things within me. And I put him first and it was good. And man, the blessings that come after that are wonderful. Now, so that's what it means when he says, you know, taking up our cross, willing to identify with him publicly, means being willing to live for him and allowing things to die off of us. Now, verse 39 says, if you cling to your life, you will lose it, but if you give up your life for me, you will find it. This is saying that clinging to this life may cause us to forfeit the best that Christ has for us within this life. You know, there are things that feel good, but man, we know they're not good for us. There are things that we go through that it's like, no, I'm going to get through this in my own power. I don't need anyone's help. But Christ is saying, hey, if you cling to this life, you're missing it. Because I have more for you than this world has to offer. I have more for you than
any societal thing can offer you. I care about you. I have so much more for you. Follow me. Because if you cling to this life, you're going to do it in your own strength and crash and burn. Man, that's not good. But clinging to Jesus, wow, he can make a way when there is no way. Now, Jesus wants so much more for us than to just be successful or powerful. He didn't carry the cross so we could be consumed with making it by society's standards. Jesus carried the cross for each of us so that we could be set free from sin, so that we could be set free from shame, so that we could be set free from bondage, from those family chains. Where we see our parents do something, you know, and then all of a sudden it's like, okay, am I going to make that choice to follow? It's a lot easier to break off those chains with Jesus Christ. Because, man, he knows no limits. There's so much more within Jesus than what the world has to offer. Now, let's go back to Matthew 16, 24 through 27. 24 says, "Then Jesus said to his disciples, 'If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross, and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it.'" Sounds familiar, right? Jesus said this twice. Just these two, he said it more than that. But these are the two we're using today. Jesus repeated himself a lot because we're human. The disciples were human. I mean, how many of us in this room have children or coworkers that we have to repeat ourselves 15,000 times and we're like, come on, I already taught you how to do this 10 times, get it already. Or, hey, we're leaving, we do the same thing to go to school every day. Why don't you have your shoes on? You know you have to wear shoes to school. Legitimate conversation. I have 4 out of the 5 days of my week. And I'm like, buddy, we do this every single day, come on. Well, we're human too. Sometimes we're a little thick-headed. Jesus repeats himself because he wants us to get it. He wants us to hear him. Now, here's my favorite, verse 26. "And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Is anything worth more than your soul?" Wow. What is our soul worth? What is it worth? Man, Jesus answers this so many times. But he answered it in the biggest way possible. Our souls were worth Jesus' life. Our souls were worth Jesus' comfort. Wow, that's hard to comprehend, isn't it? Someone that we've never met face to face in the flesh could care about us and our souls so much that he gave up his life. That's amazing. You know, that God sent his only son to die on the cross for us. Wow, is the ultimate sacrifice. That we could have a freedom from sin, a forgiveness, hope, and eternity in heaven. These are just a few things. But that's what our soul is worth. Our soul is worth the only son of God coming and going through an unimaginable. He was beaten to where you couldn't recognize him. They can't show that in the movies. They can't show that on TV. He was unrecognizable. And he did it without the narcotic. If you read in Matthew a little bit earlier, it says that they tried to give him sour wine mixed with gall. Gall was a narcotic that they used back in the New Testament days. But Jesus refused it. He wanted to be completely clear-headed. Wow, that just amazes me even more. So that is what I pray that sinks in a little bit, that's what our souls are worth. They're worth way more than we could ever understand. Now, which is why verse 24, "Then Jesus said to his disciples, 'If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross and follow me. He doesn't say this because he's selfish. He's not a selfish God. I don't know if I could lay down my life for people I don't know. Right? If we're real and we think about that, maybe in the heat of the moment. But man, he doesn't say this because he doesn't say this because he's selfish. He says, if you want to follow me, you must give up your own way and take up your cross and follow me. If you want to follow me. We have this beautiful thing, also painful thing, called free will. We get to choose if we want Jesus as our Lord and Savior. We get to choose the path that we take. And I can tell you firsthand, I've lived the other way. And I chased it, and Matt chased it, and it was empty. It was empty. I mean, yeah, in the moment it felt good. But then the next day came and something was missing. And I know so many others in this room. Man, we could tell our stories, and that's actually coming up. We're going to do a tell your story thing again because it's real. But Jesus is so good, so good. He's the good shepherd, and he goes ahead of us, and he knows what tomorrow holds. He does, but he also knows how to get us through it when we don't. Now, Jesus knows that where our own ways will get us. He will guide us every step of the way. So, for instance, Jesus knows what tomorrow holds. I use my kids a lot until they get a little bit older, and then I can't use them anymore. But it's just like, you know, being a parent or being an aunt or being a babysitter, we know, okay, we know what the outcome is if you eat a bag of chocolate for every meal, right? Kids, they would eat a bag of chocolate and or sour candy for every meal if we let them, wouldn't they? I know. I mean, I probably would too if I didn't get sick. But that first day, if we just let them do whatever they wanted in their own way, that first day, yeah, they'd probably eat 3 or 4 bags of candy and be like, oh man, that was great. That next day, they're going to start feeling a little sick. And then so on and so forth. Then you add in the sugar. I'm sure your body starts shutting down because there's only so many nutrients from Reese's Peanut Butter Cups. And I mean, it goes on and on and on. We know what's going to happen, but they don't. Are you with me? It's the same with God and us. He knows what's going to happen when we don't. And sometimes we don't like it, but that's where trust comes in. That's where faith comes in. That we know that he holds our tomorrow and he is good. He has proven himself over and over again to be good. And man, when we put our lives, our souls in his hands, the things that happen, the freedom that comes is amazing. Now, when we turn from our selfish ways, not the good things about us, there's a lot of memes out there on the internet that say, picking up your cross means letting everything die and following Jesus. No, we have good things. We're not just all sin and bad, okay? We're made in the image of Jesus Christ. We have good things. There are things that he has given us talents for. You know, instruments. I can't play the guitar to save my life. So you know what? Every morning, I should probably die to the thought of me playing guitar, to be honest with you. But we each have a different gifting from God. Some of us, it's kindness. That's good. Don't kill that. No. Some of us, it's caring. Some of us, it's that straightforward honesty. You know? Some of us, it's prayer. Man, we got that gift of intercession and that prayer. It's amazing. We're not supposed to die to the good things. It's the things that hold us back that we're supposed to let go of. Now, we must deny the human desires that will keep us stuck, that hurt others, and so on. How we live this life is so brief of a time span of eternity when you look at it. It's just but a mist is what Scripture says. But what we accumulate here on this earth, it doesn't gain us entry into heaven. We can be a good person all day long. But Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. The only way to the Father is through me. Don't take my word for it. Look it up. The only way to eternity is through Jesus Christ and having that relationship with him. And it is worth it. You know, God didn't give us just a book of rules to make us miserable. No. It's an instruction manual on how to navigate the hardness of life. It's a guidebook that's alive and can transform us. You know, it's amazing because when we're going through something, we can look to it and be like, okay, that's how they got through it. Lord Jesus, help me. And then we have one another. We're not alone. We're created to pray for one another, to encourage one another, sometimes to kick each other in the butt. We all need a good butt kick every once in a while to get into gear. But we have community together. You know, when Jesus says we must take up our cross, crucifixion was a common Roman method of execution. And the condemned criminals had to carry their cross through the streets to the execution site. So when he said this, the disciples knew exactly what he meant. Now, for us, what does that mean? It means following Jesus is a commitment. Just like a relationship, a friendship, a marriage. It's a commitment that we make. And we must be willing to not turn back when times get hard. You know, when the condemned criminals had to carry their cross, I'm sure it got hard. But they couldn't turn back. They had to keep going. And that's what Jesus is saying, is we must keep going. But he tells us how we can keep going with him. Now, this is the best part. Are you ready for the best part? I say that about all the things. I just really love scripture, you guys. The best part means when life gets hard, as it will, as it does, and we want to give in, we must remind ourselves that we are children of God. That even when we're mad at him, even when we don't understand, even when we want to hightail it and run the other way, even when we want to just give in and let somebody have it, we are his. We are his. I don't love my children any less when they lose their temper. I don't love my children any less when they come to me and they're like, I'm mad at you. And I'm like, okay, why are you mad at me? It's usually a very profound reason. My kids are 7. Very profound reason. Usually because I won't let Elijah buy a hermit crab right now. He's like, Mom, I'm mad at you. And I'm like, why? He goes, I could have bought a crab by now. I said, well, buddy, no. Sorry, you got to show me you're responsible first. But I don't love him any different because he's mad at me. God already knows how we feel. He gave us feelings. Feelings aren't bad. They're dangerous when we allow them to control us, though. And that's the difference. We're supposed to feel our feelings. But when they start dictating our actions and controlling us, that's when it's dangerous. Now, all right, here's the best part. You thought that was the best part. Here's the best part. We don't have to do it alone. So this sounds like a lot and super overwhelming, right? It does. But that's the glory of it. With Jesus Christ, we don't have to do it alone. You know, in our own strength, when we cling on to this life, we're doing it in our own will, our own strength. But in Scripture, it says that we have the Holy Spirit. Scripture calls the Holy Spirit an advocate, a helper. And so when we ask Jesus Christ in as our Lord and Savior, we automatically receive the Holy Spirit. And I always say it, and I will die saying this, I need the Holy Spirit to go to Walmart, okay? We all do, because that parking lot is crazy, all right? We all know it. It's true. So, but we receive the Holy Spirit, and we don't have to do this life alone. The Holy Spirit helps us. When we're weak, he strengthens us. And he brings people alongside of us to pray for us and to help take that load. That's the best part. is that we're never alone, no matter how alone we may feel. Again, feel our feelings, but we can't allow them to dictate our life. So we don't have to turn from selfish ways alone when we make that commitment to Jesus. I'm grateful for that. For a Savior that comes and says, I want a relationship with you. Now, to pick up our cross and to follow him means when we say yes, we're not going to run. We're going to stick it out. We're going to follow him and allow him to work within us. That no matter what comes against us, we're going to say, no, my God is bigger than this situation. My God is bigger than this problem. Can I tell you one last story? One last one? So this last week, and we didn't say it. Matt, you okay if I tell this story? Okay. I like he knows what I'm going to tell. He just gave me a thumbs up. Poor guy. When your wife has a microphone. So this last week, so as many of you know, and if not, Emily, our girl, has been having a lot of health issues this last year. A lot of them. And we couldn't figure out why. She's gone through a lot of testing and stuff, and this past Monday night, her pediatrician called us that evening and said, hey, I've been putting some things together, and when I put it all together, she has all the symptoms and everything points that she has a genetic hormone disorder that's causing a brain tumor in her pituitary gland. That's what they said. That's what she said. And I'm sitting there like, okay. She's like, now, it could also be, you know, insulin resistance and this, but she said just the fact that she had her eyesight and started getting headaches. All of a sudden, it could be a coincidence because it's about the age kids get glasses, right? It could be all these things. But her doctor said, I want to just be straight with you. This is what I found. So if you'll bring her in tomorrow, we'll do blood work. Of course, you know, I get off that call and I'm like winded. You know, you get that call and you're like, what are we facing? And I'm telling Matt and he's just looking at me. I honestly don't think we even spoke anything to each other after that night. You get winded. And I hit my knees that night after everybody went to bed. And I said, Jesus, we gave her to you. When she was born, you gave her to us and we dedicated her to you. She is yours. And this is scary and I don't like this. And I'm sick of our girl going through all these tests. But she's yours. And you'll be our strength no matter what the outcome. We prayed that week. And Good Friday comes. And we get a call right before our Good Friday service from her pediatrician that says, hey, did all the blood work on all the things in her body. Her blood came back exceptionally low for the hormone disorder. She does not have the genetic hormone disorder or a tumor in her pituitary gland, or however you say it. And man, Matt and I, we're at the back of the church, and we're looking at each other, tearing up. And I was like, thank you, Jesus, because no matter what, you are going to see us through it. You have her because she is yours. Yeah, fear comes in. Fear, all these things that you feel, and you can't even put it into words, and you're blindsided. Now, she said, of course, you know, I'm glad she led with that. And then she said, well, her A1C was high. So now she needs to go for specialties to see if she's insulin resistant or, you know, type of diabetes. But man, after having to look at brain surgery, we'll deal with it. We will eat vegetables, okay? There is no more sugar allowed in our house. I don't care what we have to do. But now we have an answer as to why she's going through so many other things. All of that to say, God is good. He is a personal God. No matter what we face, We can have a hope within him, even when we're scared, even when we don't like what's going on. Man, Jesus is that rock, and we can trust him and his word no matter what's happening. Because there's a hope in him, a hope in this life. When we're down, when we're battling things, Jesus says, I see you. I see you. And I care about you. I care where you're going. I care where you've been. I'm sorry others have used their free will to hurt you. I'm sorry life circumstances aren't panning out the way, but that's not me. Hold on to me and I will get you through. That's what Jesus says. That's why he carried the cross. That's why Jesus asked us to turn from our own ways and trust him. Because when we get the phone calls we don't want to get, who do we turn to? No human relationship can sustain me and my emotions the way Jesus Christ can. No human relationship can heal the way Jesus Christ can. There's no hope in another the way there is in Jesus. But he's easy to blame and he's got big shoulders and he'll take it. But at some point we got to say, all right, Jesus, I don't like this. It doesn't make sense, but I'm going to trust you because I'm tired of living in this way myself. So each of you have received a cross this morning. If you haven't, you will receive one. It's tiny. They do fit on your keychains. Because Jesus asked us to pick up our own cross each day and follow him. That means when we say yes to him, staying the course and not walking away when it gets hard. And these crosses serve as a reminder that no matter what comes our way, if it's on our keys or if you want to put it somewhere you see it, set it on your dashboard, wherever, take a picture, make it your backdrop, that the cross takes all of that. We can do it because we're not alone. We're not alone. We have the power of Jesus Christ within us. We have the Holy Spirit. We have one another. And this cross shows us that we can make it. And we can put all of our burdens on him. He's got big hands and a big shoulder. And he knows us more than anyone. So this morning, are we ready? Are we ready to follow Jesus? Maybe we've known Jesus our entire life. That's good. We still have to continually say yes to him. Just because we've known Jesus for 100 years doesn't mean that we get to stop saying yes to him. Because we're still flesh too. We're still human. And we get to say, okay, Jesus, I'm going to follow you. I'm going to trust you. I'm going to give this a shot. I'm going to keep trusting you when it's hard. There are days I got to say that 50 times a day. There have been days I've been sitting by a hospital bed and every other word's, Jesus, I trust you. Jesus, I don't feel like I trust you, but I'm trusting you. Because he gets us through it every time. Every time. So this morning, where are you at? Whether you're here or watching online, where are you at? Nobody can make this decision for us. I made it for myself. We have that cool thing called free will. What's the Lord speaking to you this morning? Are you like, man, I'm tired. I'm worn out. I feel like I'm battling against a brick wall. I need some relief. That relief can be found in Jesus. Or maybe you're empowered today. You're like, man, I'm on this. Jesus, let's keep going. I'm going to take up this cross and we're going to keep going. Because right now we got traction and nothing's going to stop us. Either way, where are we at this morning? I want us just to take a few moments and just talk to him. Where you are, or the altars are always open. Take your cross and look at it. Where are we at? Where are you at today? Are you ready to say yes? Jesus, I'm going to keep following you. I'm going to pick up my cross. Are you still questioning. Hey, asking questions is great because there's a lot to be answered. Hold on to that cross and ask questions every time you see it. Now, with all eyes closed, maybe you're here and you're like, man, I haven't talked to Jesus in a long time. Maybe you've never asked Jesus in as your Lord and Savior because he's always been this distant being. Or maybe you've gone through tremendous pain. And you're like, God, why? He wants to hold you. He doesn't want you to go through this alone. He wants to hold you and say, I'm sorry. I am sorry that happened. I am sorry. Let me hold you so we can make it right. I'm so sorry, my child. Trust me and guide me. If you're ready for that this morning and you just want to ask Jesus in as your Lord and Savior, either again or for the first time, I would love to pray with you. No one's eyes are open but mine and a couple little ones. So if you would slip up your hands, I would just love to pray with you. Thank you. Thank you. Right now, if that's you, just repeat after me. Lord, I come to you this morning and I give you my life. I trust you. Forgive me of my sins. Guide me. Hold me. And lead me from this moment on. In your name, Jesus. Amen. Now, right now, just take just a couple more minutes, just a couple more moments. Just talk to Jesus. Where are you at? Lord, right now, as we seek you, open up our hearts and our minds for where you're taking us, your goodness. You know every need within this room and watching online, God. You come in right now and you just meet us exactly where we are. Speak to us, Lord. Lord, thank you. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for this day that we get to celebrate you. Lord, we just thank you for who you are. Lord, right now I pray blessing. I pray blessing over each person here. God, and each person watching with us today, I pray blessing over their lives, over their families. I pray against the enemy and anything that he wants to cause within them. I pray against doubt. And Lord, I pray that you just bless them. You bless every one of them. Because God, you are good. Even when circumstances aren't, you are good. So Lord, I pray blessing as we go about our week. Lord, hold us close to you. Guide us. Remind us that we're not in this alone, no matter how we feel. And that you are leading. You are leading us no matter where we go. Lord, we love you and ask this in your mighty name, Jesus. Amen. What a great day of celebration. Next week, we're going to move into, we talked about carrying our cross. It looks a little different depending in what relationships are. So We're going to move in to a series called Carrying Our Cross. Next week it's going to be in relationships. How do we carry our cross if we're single? How do we carry our cross in a marriage, in a dating relationship? And then after that, we're going to move into carrying our cross in family dynamics. We all have a family dynamic. Not two are the same. How do we do that? How do we follow Jesus and pick up that cross without looking back in those family dynamics? So that's what we're moving into in the next couple weeks. And we'd love to have you join us. Today is, as you leave at both doors, you will receive just a little gift from the Lenten Assembly leadership here. If you like chocolate and peanut M&Ms, it's all about it. If you don't, bless someone else. It's a win-win all around. And also, if you have kiddos, we have an Easter egg hunt right after service. If you leave the back doors, it'll be to the right-hand side. Now I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Worland. So thank you all for coming. Have a blessed week and an amazing Easter.
Aren't you glad we serve a risen Savior? The tomb is empty. Everything we have belongs to Him. He's blessed us so much. He just asked us to give a small portion back of our many, many blessings. Father, we thank you for your love, your mercy, your grace, your many blessings. You're truly fresh and new every morning. We just ask that you'd bless this offering, use it for your glory. Just have your way. In Jesus' name, amen.